Brenda Song, welcome to the IMDb show.
Oh wow. Thank you for having me.
It still amazes me that takes everyone by surprise.
It is, I just wasn't expecting it.
You should have that every morning when you wake up
and
before you go to sleep.
All my animals.
Yeah, there you go, all your animals.
My cats.
Congrats, great to have you here.
Oh, thank you.
Secret Obsession.
Yes.
Is your latest film on Netflix.
Yes, sir.
Here's what we know so far. Your character, has amnesia from a trauma.
Yes.
Trying to piece together memories, right?
Yes.
To figure things out. Break down the movie plot line for me.
So after a traumatic accident, my character Jennifer wakes up in the hospital and doesn't remember anything. But she's presented with a handsome, lovely husband, a beautiful home, a life that anyone would die for.
So what's the problem?
Exactly. Until it slowly starts unraveling that everything's not what it seems.
Not so handsome.
whoa, don't say that too loud. Love you, Mike.
But that's the thing, right? But from the very beginning, it starts getting very sinister.
Yes, and I think that's what I really kind of drew me to this. Well, first of all, I love the thriller genre. It's one of my personal favorites to watch,
what?
To read. I don't know what it is about people loving to scare themselves, but I love it. And since I was a kid, it started out with like Goosebumps and then like started reading mysteries like Nancy Drew, Hardy Boys.
Uh-huh.
And then as I got older, I loved, you know, Stephen King and Rule, all those sorts of like
what
dark books.
What movie freaked you? Like, which is, everyone's got this one movie.
That freaks them out.
Which
Nightmare
one?
On Elm Street. Oh. I was a kid, I walked in, saw my parents watching it, and they used to scare me with Freddy Krueger. And also Misery. And my mom used to say, Annie's gonna come get you. Yeah.
That's some child abuse.
I know, right? Yeah. Like, I'm okay, I swear. And I think when I read this script, there was like sort of this Misery aspect, which I loved about it. And the movie starts you like straight up with the action. Like there's no like slow build up. The twist kind of comes early and the audience is actually ahead of Jennifer. So you're kind of waiting for her to catch up, which is different. And it was really interesting for me because I've never really done a role like this before. My body of work has been very lighthearted and fun and very silly. And me personally, I love watching such dark things that when this came about, I was like, really? They want me for this? Really? I was like so excited to just be able to delve into something different and to challenge myself. As an actor, you know, I think that's the most exciting thing is seeing a project and seeing how I can make that me or to make that real to me. Because people always ask, I think as an actor, they go, what is your dream role? And I was like, that almost takes the fun out of my
job. Stop, have you read my cards?
Oh no!
Because that
Wait,
does
really?
Come up a bit. Yes, later
no,
on. I swear to God, look, right here.
Lies somewhere.
No, I swear here, boom. It's there.
Okay, dream role. I always say it's always difficult for me, at least personally, to give you what my dream role is because that's part of the fun of my job is getting something, getting a role and going, can I do that? Do I suit that? Can I make that work? How do I make that real for me? Because every actor is different and every actor is going to bring something different to a role. And I'm starting to realize that, you know, you have to be really honest and real with yourself about the characters that you can play and the characters that you can pull off realistically. So, you know, that's a part of, you know, the fun of my job. And that's what was fun about reading this was like, can I do this?
So what was the biggest challenge about this? You know your limitations. You know where you want to evolve and
yes.
become a better actor. So what did you see on the page that you immediately like, that's challenging. I got to be able to climb that mountain.
The most challenging part was just to put myself in that dark, like, mindset. I've been very fortunate, and I'm a very happy-go-lucky person. So it's like, for me to be, when you play these parts, you physically, mentally, emotionally are there. And day in and day out on set, we have such a good time. Mike and I had such a great time. You want the set to be a fun environment. But when you're working on such a dark film, which I've never really done before, it was a really hard balance to be able to be chatting like this.
Right.
And then all of a sudden jumping into, you know, crying and like, you know, putting yourself in the mindset of, I'm stuck in this house with someone I don't know, trapped in this room, you know, whatever it is, whether it's, you know, me being literally, you know, chained down to the bed or whatever. It was a really hard juxtaposition. And I found that really challenging because I think as an actor, you also have to remember, it's not just about performance, but you're also setting the tone on a set, which
right.
is also very important. And that was something that was also really great about this, working with Peter Sullivan, our director, and with Mike Vogel, we had to to really create a safe environment, because we did a lot of very vulnerable, scary things for actors. I had to really trust Mike, and Mike is so lovely. Like, he literally is physically actually just carrying me and actually tying me down and doing all sorts of things. And I'm so grateful to work with someone who not only is such a fantastic actor, but such a good and amazing human being, that I felt so safe at every moment doing all of this. So therefore, I didn't have to think about that. And I can really just delve in into letting myself be vulnerable and letting myself go to those places without having to worry about anything else. I knew that Peter and Mike, they had my back. And if I ever felt weird or anything, you know, they were the first ones to be like, okay, let's stop. Let's not do this. And the thing about it is getting into these the characters, like, I didn't want to, which is, there's nothing wrong with it, but I didn't want to use any blowers. I didn't want to do any of that because I wanted to
any
be
able, what?
Like any blowers to help like you get teary and
okay,
things
gotcha.
Like that.
Right.
Because I was like, if I can't as
wait,
an actor,
so they blow air into your eyes,
like menthol.
Okay.
Which is great because sometimes you know you want to be able to control your tears. You want to, after crying all day, you're like, I just can't do it anymore. Or they need something specific. It's wonderful, but because this was the first time that I really had a chance to go there. If I wasn't going to be able to cry in this scene, then I was like, then there shouldn't be tears. Because in me physically, I was not in a place where tears would come. If they're going to come, I want them to come naturally. Because I want this character to feel as natural for me as possible. Because sometimes, you know, it's like you think a line should be said this way.
Right.
Or a scene should look this way. And that's not how it works. You know, sometimes you go in there and it completely changes. And that's really important. You have to honor that as an actor to go, okay, you know what? I'm not, this scene, I shouldn't be crying because we're doing it and I'm not crying, you know? And so I shouldn't be crying.
Right.
And I was really grateful to have Peter who and Mike who were so open to those changes and allowing us to have that rehearsal time in the morning to get to where we needed to go, which was really fun.
It's an interesting thing. I had Carla Gugino come on the show, right?
Amazing.
Amazing, with her new show, Jet. She told me, I was talking about Watchmen. If you've ever seen that movie, do you remember that super traumatic scene where she plays the victim?
Yes.
And she gets beaten up really badly by Jeffrey Dean Morgan's character. She told me something super interesting. As an actor working alongside another actor, the person who feels bad about that scene is the aggressor. Is Jeffrey Dean Morgan's character.
Oh, yeah.
Where she's like, don't worry.
Do it. Go
I'll
all
let
out.
You
yeah.
know. Is that the same? So you concur with that?
100%. I think Mike asked me more times than, are you okay? Is that too much? Do I? And he was so, he's got three kids. He's been married for, you know, forever. He's so respectful. And it is so important. But at the same time, I was like, I will promise, I will tell you if you know, if we ever cross the line, but you know, we have to make it feel as real as possible. And to go there, you have to, you know, there are no physical boundaries. You know, he's literally physically grabbing me. He felt so bad because I got bruises, scrapes and bruises from being grabbed, being thrown around, all these things. And every day I would come and I would like have to hide them because he'd be like, oh my God, I actually hurt you. I was like, no, dude. I was like, this is a part of it. We, you know, this is, you know, we're doing this.
Right.
Like, even though we're acting, we are in these scenarios. Like, you are actually doing these things to me, you know? And it's okay. Like, there is a fine line, especially when it comes to, you know, movies that are so physical and emotional like this. But if you're working with someone that you trust and you have an open communication, it's amazing. And I'm so fortunate that for my first time being in a project like this, I had such a wonderful cast and crew to, you know, go forth on this venture with.
And we also live in a world now where we have so many movies, so many TV shows. As viewers, we've seen it.
Oh, yeah.
And we can see right through it.
Oh,
so
yeah,
if it's not authentic, it doesn't work. It doesn't sell.
Exactly. Right. And that's what's important is in, not that if we don't feel like it's real in the moment, the audience is definitely not going to feel like it's real in the moment.
There is, you were talking before about having to switch into that dramatic mode super quickly, right? What sort of things does the director do to make you as actors feel comfortable from going like this into full drama?
He was, Peter was wonderful because we realized that he would just start rolling the camera and then give me, whether it was 30 seconds, 5 seconds, or 5 minutes of me just getting to this headspace and taking my own cues And if we were in it, just to keep going. So within our like three takes, we may have like 15.
Okay.
And it was great because sometimes when you're in that emotional place, it's so hard to get yourself out of it. And sometimes you have to do it again because you know what, we are filming. So sometimes you weren't in focus or you were not on your mark or something. Someone saw a boom or something so small. I mean, this is a production where it's not just about the actors. It's about a whole, everyone in this room. We're all working together. And so it is sometimes jarring, especially when, you know, you're so emotional, you're crying, you're being thrown around, and you have to remember, okay, I have to stay in this mark. I have to open up because the light is there, and we're all trying to do our job and do the, like, you know, make it work. So it is, sometimes it's hard because you're like, that was my best take, but I wasn't on my mark. My head was leaned into the right pillow, and no one could see me. And, you know, it's all these little things that people don't think about that really actually go into making a scene.
Actors tell me all the time they learn something new from every project that they do. Give me one thing that you learned from this particular project that you'll keep with you throughout your career.
That apparently I am very dramatic and can cry all the time on anything. And also the fact that what I loved so much about this was that I could do it.
Okay.
I think that's something that was, I didn't, going into it, I was actually kind of nervous, like, you know, more so than anyone. Is like, could I, can I do this? Can I take myself to these places?
What were you doubtful of?
Well, just
this, look, you're somebody who's got 72 credits on your IMDb page. At 72
That's
working
crazy.
Jobs, 72 different experiences.
I feel so grateful to be able to say that.
What did you think that you couldn't do?
Well, first of all, the fact that, you know, I had this amazing opportunity to not just be a part of a genre that I love so much. It's the first time that I'm doing it, but also to be the lead in that project, it was very daunting. Because for me, growing up in this industry with these 72 projects, there aren't a lot of opportunities, especially, you know, just in the last few years it's changed. But growing up, I didn't have the opportunities to star in my own projects,
right,
to have, you know, the opportunities to be in movies like this. And so when the opportunity came, I didn't want to mess it up. You know, I wanted to be able to not only do the best of my capabilities, but also be able to represent it well so we can continue to make movies like this for everyone else out there. Because I think it's really important. Growing up, I didn't have a lot of people who looked like me on TV. And that was really hard. And so when I have the opportunities now to do something like this, I hope to do it as best as I can so it does well so we can continue to make projects like this for all actors out there.
You mean you got offered a role that wasn't about an immigrant family coming to America? What?
Which are great stories to tell, but that's one
thing. Looking for love?
But that's one thing that I do love about this project and what Netflix is doing is that it's not, even though it is wonderful to tell the stories that are very culturally based, it's also really wonderful to just have stories where it's not about that, it's just about people. Because that is what, you know, we are. We're just people living our lives and we don't have to, we don't come in and say, hi, I'm Brenda, I'm half Thai and half Hmong and this is my story. But I'm just, you know, living my life. And it is very important to tell those stories as well. But it's also nice to just have leads of all ethnicities, diversities, just telling stories.
Beautiful. Your next project that's coming out is Dollface.
Yes.
What a great cast. Kat Dennings, Shay Mitchell, Esther Pavitsky.
Yeah.
What can you tell us about this project?
Well, Dollface is is a very female-led show, as you can see. It's actually produced by Margot Robbie. Our creator is 20. She just turned 26. And this is
overachiever.
I know, right? It's ridiculous. Every day I walk into set and I was like, you're just writing, like creating your own show at 26. I'm like, it's incredible though, because to have a show coming from someone who is living and this is sort of her story, living in this moment, it feels really authentic.
So what's the story?
So the story is Kat Dennings has been in a relationship with her boyfriend for 5 years and he breaks up with her. And I think everybody has either been in a situation or done it themselves, is while she's been in this relationship, she's neglected all of her girlfriends. And so she has to integrate herself back into the female world. And what's fun about Dollface is there's a hyper-real aspect to it. So when she comes back to the feminine world, she a bus pulls up, and instead of a greyhound, it's a pink bus with like a cat on it, driven by a literal cat lady. And this cat lady, no, like a literal animated cat lady.
Oh, so cat face.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, yeah.
And she's
like, oh, yeah, like that makes sense.
Yeah, and she guides Kat Dennings back into the female world. And I play Madison, Kat's college roommate, her best friend, who she's neglected, and I'm out of her friend group, the one that is not willing to let her back in.
Oh.
And so this show is, that's what gets you into it. But what this show really is just about is four girls and their trials and tribulations, not only through life in LA, but their friendships and what that entails. Like, what happens when, you know, you're so hurt that you feel like your friends abandoned you? What happens when you've skipped 5 years? Sometimes things aren't the way they used to be. And throughout all of this, there's this crazy hyperreal aspect that Kat sort of goes through when she has the obstacles of, you know, dealing with feminine issues.
You probably don't have experience being kidnapped by a psychotic person and trapped and chained to a bed. But what you probably do have is experience with what you're dealing with in Dollface.
Yes.
How does that help a performance, and what's that like?
It's, well, first of all, like, you know, when you haven't done something, like been kidnapped and all that, it's really fun because you sort of live out this weird fantasy that, like, as an actor, you know, you have a lot of scenarios.
Yeah.
And you're like, I wish I could do it. Wouldn't that be fun? Like, it sounds terrible and, like, really messed up. But so it's fun to kind of, like, live out of, exactly.
Yeah.
But then with Dollface, what really was wonderful was that, you know, every script that we got, all of us were like, oh, we've done this. Oh, we've been here.
Right.
Oh, we've done that.
Guilty.
Oh, yeah, completely. And the show is based in LA, and we shot all around Los Angeles. So, like, we're hiking through Runyon Canyon. We're, you know, taking Ubers to downtown when no one wants to go to downtown to go to, like, an opening of a party. It's, like, stuff like that that I'm like,
God,
I've been there.
Describing my life.
Exactly. And it's, you know, us in traffic. It's us doing all these things that you're just like, oh, yeah, done that, been there. And what's really great also about this show, about, you know, having, you know, these four girls that are very different, we're all very different, and I just feel like audiences watching it, you can relate to, you'll find someone, whether it's an aspect of your personality or you are like this person. Because even when I was reading, I was like, oh, I'm a little bit of this and a lot of this,
right,
of these different characters. So I think that's really fun. It's like really relatable. We like to say it's kind of like a New Girl meets Sex in the City.
I love both those shows,
yeah,
so
great.
I'm in. I'm sold. Sweet Life is Zack and Cody,
yes.
Something that you did. You were the hilarious London Tipton.
Oh, goodness gracious.
Great name, by the way. Looking back at those years, how many years were you on that show?
We were on the show for 7 years, seven, almost 8 years.
Hugely popular.
I wouldn't be here without it, so I'm internally grateful.
Does that help or hinder the growing up process in getting new roles post that life?
There is a really fine line, because I obviously wouldn't be here without that show. It is incredible. They, you know, Disney gave me incredible opportunities. And, you know, they were doing things that they were ahead of the curve.
What were they doing that made that show so special?
Well, first of all, because again, they were so open. I mean, at the time, Disney Channel was giving me my own TV movies, which was, you know, at 17, 18, like, it made me really excited that kids could watch and see, like, oh, look at this Asian American actress on TV. Like, that's so inspiring. And, you know, they were doing that, you know, 10, 15 years ago,
right,
which is incredible. But I think the thing that's so great about Disney, my experience with Disney, is that me personally working on it, I got to, as a kid, go to work, live out my dream, and do it in an incredibly safe environment, and making a product that I knew that my cousins, my family could watch and be proud of, and I could look back on it and be like, I was, you know, I had so much fun doing it, and I made a really fun show. That being said, doing that show between the ages of like 16 and 22 is hard because, you know.
Because you're playing how old on the show?
I'm playing, you know, I was playing like 16, 17.
At 22.
At 22.
Okay.
And so coming out of it, you know, you want to make that transition into being a young adult. And it's really hard because, especially when you're on a TV show and you're in people's living rooms every day, first of all, they feel like they know you, but they only know you as that person.
Right.
And so when they see your face, they know you as London Tipton. And it's a blessing because, you know, the opportunities that I have because of it. But at the same time, when you want to make that transition, it's really hard to allow people to believe that you can be other people, especially when they've known you for so long as one person. And I think that was the thing that coming out of Disney was, you know, everyone was like, well, you have to do something dark. Do something dark and something crazy and, you know, to show people that you can act and do something different. And I personally wasn't ready for that, like, emotionally.
You mean as an actor or as your...
As a person,
okay.
I wasn't ready. I was, like, coming out of a show where I was, you know, I was still so young, and even though I was 22, I was probably, you know, 18. I'd never gone to a house party before.
Oh, wow.
Things like that. Yeah, truly. You know, the first time I saw marijuana, I thought it was potpourri.
What's marijuana?
Exactly. Right? And so it was like, there was this, you know, like I was still as a person trying to grow. And I was very fortunate coming out of that, that I was getting jobs that allowed me to grow with my characters. Like right off the bat, you know, I was able to jump on a show like Scandal where I was playing an assistant. And it was like kind of being like pulled into this like adult world, but not jumping full in. I didn't feel like I had to pretend to be something that I wasn't yet. Because I think as an actor, the older I get and the more life experience I have, I do realize that it really does dictate my performance.
Really?
Yeah, because I can emulate heartbreak of like, you know, my first breakup. But it wasn't until I think I had my first breakup where I really knew what it feels like. And it actually changes my outlook on it. And it really did change my outlook on acting the older I got. And I really was just mindful coming out of Disney to do things that first of all inspired me and that I was ready for. Because I think that was the easy thing, was just to jump in and do something really dark. But I feel like it wouldn't have been organic for me, because I wasn't there and I wasn't, you know, I didn't understand that I would just be pretending the whole time. And yes, we are in a world of make-believe, but I wanted to be able to be as authentic as possible. And I was really fortunate, you know, I got to do right out of the gate, I got to do, you know, shows like Scandal, shows like New Girl, and then I jumped onto like a show like Dad's, where I was working with a league of actors that I just sat and watched, working with Peter Riegert, Martin Mull, Giovanni Ribisi, Seth Green, who have been in this industry forever. And Giovanni and Seth being child actors themselves, I just quiz them every single day because...
Best piece of advice they gave you?
Seth Green said to me, your career is shaped by, not by the things that you say yes to, but by the things you say no to.
Fair enough.
And it's very, very true. Because when an opportunity arises, you want to say yes to everything because you're like, you're so grateful and you're so excited. But then again, you have to sort of think of the long run of what kind of actor do you want to be? Like when people say your name, what do you want them to associate you with? And I think that was really important advice and something that I, you know, remind myself of all the time. And that show taught me a lot, working on Dad's, because it was a very controversial show that a lot of people didn't like. You know, the writers were from, and the creators from Family Guy. So it was very, very controversial. And we did the TCAs for it, and it was a firing line. They were just trashing our shows to our faces. And I loved working on that show so much, and I'm so proud of it. And we stood tall and was like, we love our show, and it's not for everyone, but we really enjoyed making it, and we think we're doing something fun. Not every show needs to have a political message or something. Sometimes you need to just escape for 22 minutes.
Just escape.
Yeah, and so from then on, I really sort of like look at my career that way, is I don't want to do projects that I won't stand on the firing line for. I want to do things that I'm proud of and that I can look back on and be like, you know what? I'm proud of that.
It's funny. I'm watching Euphoria at the moment.
Oh,
have you seen this?
No, I haven't. I've heard about it.
So Zendaya.
Yes,
is
incredible.
Someone who's grown up super famous.
Yeah.
And when you watch the first episode of Euphoria, you're like, whoa, big difference.
Amazing.
So she's made that conscious decision to go down this, you know, she plays kind of a teenage drug addict who's trying to rehab, but she's doing it so
that's
well.
Incredible.
And then on the flip side, she's in Spider-Man.
Yeah, and that's what's so amazing, to see that like range from someone so young is so inspiring. Like, you know, I wasn't brave enough to do that. Like, I was like, I'm not ready to play a drug addict. And, you know, and I was 22. I was like, I don't even know what all drugs are.
I thought marijuana was potpourri.
Yeah, exactly. And to see that from someone who is so young and has such a career ahead of her is so inspiring for me. You know, and I'm 31. I think it's amazing. And
so,
you know,
between now and let's say 41, 10 years, I'll do that question that you stole off me earlier. What would be your dream role? What would you like to try that if you put it out there, maybe it'll come your way?
You know, honestly, I just want to keep challenging myself. I couldn't tell you, like, I would love to be in this scenario. There are, of course, filmmakers and actors that I would love to work with again. I've been very fortunate to work with some amazing actors. I would love to work with Fincher again. He was so inspiring in so many ways. I would love to work with
Giovanni. That was a great movie, by the way.
Oh, thank you. I mean, it's...
What did Fincher teach you?
He is... I worked on that set for 11 days, and it changed my perspective.
Better than acting school.
Beyond, because I was actually finishing up Suite Life while that audition was happening, and I didn't even tell anyone, and I just went to it during my lunch break, and they're like, oh, will you come back and read for Aaron Sorkin? I was like, no. And it just happened to fall again the next week on my lunch break. And I didn't tell anyone.
So you're like secretly going on these
missions.
Well, because
I just didn't know. And I was like, you know, they were very secretive about it. And when it all worked out, I mean, I was flabbergasted because I was literally going from working on a sitcom to working with David Fincher and Aaron Sorkin, who... Fight Club is one of my favorite movies of all time.
One of the best.
Hands down. Uh-huh. And also an incredible book. And to be working with someone that I look up to so much, I was just like a sponge. And the wonderful thing about Fincher is that he is unapologetically him. And because he...
See, I try and do that. I don't get away with it.
See, so but, go on. But, what but does the he thing have about to get it away is he doesn't try. He is just that. He knows what he wants and he does it. And he is such a visionary. And for me... We did this thing where someone asked him, like, why do you do so many takes and why do you do all these things? And he's like, he goes, I want to break everyone out of their habits. They know their lines. I just want them to do it. So they just do it. Stop thinking. And that was something he would say a lot. It was just, again, just do it again.
The takes that he used, were they the ones that you think he was going to use?
I was, honestly, I don't remember. Because you go into like this place where I said the word appletini probably like 60 times. I'm not kidding. But I understand the method to that madness because as actors, we are very vain. Right. We can't help it. Like, you know, we're rehearsing, we're doing all, you know, rehearsing over and over again. We don't want to mess up our lines. We don't want all these things. And he was just like, you know it. Now throw it away. Like, you know, why worry about the words? Like, those will come. And it taught me a lot. So working on that project really just gave me a different outlook on acting and really, like, re-inspired me as an actress. Because working on a show, regardless of what show it is, after 8 years, you have, like, you know, you have this fatigue of, like, being in, like, you're on a hamster wheel.
Right.
And so for that project to come at that time, it just, like, lit a fire under my ass. And I was like, I love this and I want to keep doing this and I'm inspired to keep working so I can work with him again because he is, I mean, I admire him so much and I love his work. I mean, continuously, you know.
And breathe.
I know, I got so excited.
Let's do our watch list. Yes. At home, when you're chilling.
Chilling.
When you have those few moments at night, what are you watching? What are you into?
We said it's cliche that like we don't watch a lot of TV, and it's the truth.
A lot of actors come in, they go, I don't watch TV. I go, really? It's true. You guys are busy.
Well, and also
learning lines and doing things.
When you come home, you kind of turn on what is easily digestible. And I'll come home and watch Top Chef. I'll watch, you know, Great British Bake Off.
Okay.
The Office.
Yes.
I stole that one from you. It's so good, and you know, there's shows that are continuously good.
So go on, let's go.
But I just did watch Chernobyl, which is amazing.
Okay.
It's really dark, but it's really good. I mean, I didn't know, going into it, of course, everyone knows what Chernobyl is, but I was like, how are they going to make this into, like, interesting? And it was great. Stellan Skarsgård is fantastic in it.
It's a funny one for me. So the first time I heard about it, it actually came out of the blue for me. Like, I didn't even see it coming.
Same.
Weirdly. Then all of a sudden, IMDb gives it amazing rating.
Yeah,
I believe it was like a 9.2 or a 9.6, something super high. Then that's corroborated by other people coming up to me, telling me. But I'm still was like a little 50-50 about tuning into it. It seems so dark and gray and bleak. What do you love about the show now that you're all the way through? I'm one episode in.
Oh, here's the thing. If you don't know a lot about it, it just does, I mean, of course, it's all dramatized. But it's an interesting way, if you don't know a lot about Chernobyl, as a viewer, to just get an insight on, you know, the overall, you know, catastrophe, which is really interesting. And the way they go about it and the way that... they kind of go into the story. It's very interesting, and I wasn't expecting it. And it tells a different kind of story. It's not just telling you what happened. Because I love docuseries. I'm a big documentary person. I'm watching Confession Tapes right now on Netflix.
Love Confession
Tapes.
So
good.
We'll save that for your next one. Yeah, but go on.
It's so good. I know I have a lot of opinions about that first episode or first two episodes. But I think what it is just I love watching like shows or movies that have a different perspective on the story, or they bring you into the story in a different way. And that's what Chernobyl kind of does. You get a bunch of different perspectives and you get stories from like the victims, but also the people on top and all of that. So you kind of get, you know, as much as you can, a roundabout opinion about what happened.
Were you mad that they didn't do it in their native accents?
What?
It should have been like in Russian accents. If it's Chernobyl.
That was one of the first things that we talked about, like that my partner and I talked about was the accents. I was like, wait, is this in... And he said something very, very true, which is if you're going to do accents, it has to be done really, really well. Otherwise, it's distracting. So might as well have them do it in, you know, whatever their natural accent, or doing a British, because, you know, British is just, you know, European. We got it. Okay, it's European.
Right.
We got it.
Right.
But yeah, no, I did think about that. I was like, it felt odd, but at the same time, I do agree with that. If it's not done well, a bad accent can almost take you out of a project. And this is something that you have to be very, very into.
Sean Connery somewhere is going, you see, I was right all the time and never picking it up. All right, what's your next one? You want to do confessions?
Yeah, confessions.
I love this.
It's
because you're twisted.
I am twisted. I love true crime and I love thrillers. And Confessions Tapes is really, really good. That first two episodes, it's hard because I know everyone has opinions because I don't think they did it. But hey,
really?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I think the confession was, I think it was a forced confession.
Forced and coerced.
Yeah. And I think that's the thing, though. It's like, you go back on it, because I've watched it again, because I was like, wait, am I wrong?
And as an actor, you can probably, like, look at that and just study them.
Well, and also because I think, like, I studied psychology when I went to school, and I was like, because I just love human behavior. And I think that's also why I love docuseries so much, because as an actor, I love seeing, like, what triggers people to do what and why, you know, people are the way they are.
Right.
And I try to steal from that, obviously. And watching this, I was like, these are two really young, you know, guys who are impressionable and who also are like, if someone told you that even if you were innocent, but police were suspecting you of something, they're like, we can make this go away if you just tell us that you did it. I was like, okay, yeah, make this go away. I'm stressed out. Make this go away. You know, I mean...
Go watch When They See Us. When you next get a second, go watch that. All right, give me your third.
I'll just have to say...
A movie or TV show, anything...
Funny Games.
Okay, go on.
Have you seen it?
I have.
And I'm talking about the remake,
because yes.
It is a shot-for-shot remake of the original. But it was something that I watched that I took inspiration from for Secret Obsessions. Secret Obsession was Funny Games because it is such a dark, twisted thriller, but there's like a home invasion aspect to it that we have aspects of that in Secret Obsession. So I watched it again to like that fear of someone invading what you think is your space and how scary that is. It's just such a great movie. It's so well done. All the performances are incredible. Brady Corbett is incredible. Michael Pitt, Naomi Watts, Tim Roth, everyone is so good in that movie.
Michael Pitt.
Oh my God, he's
creepy.
I know, and it's so good because it's a movie that you're so confused by for such a huge part of it. And
it's
then
also the psychology between the young kind of adolescence in that shit.
It's
that film.
So yeah. Great. It's the first time I watched it, I was like, I can't believe I haven't seen this sooner. I think it's really dark though. Be prepared. It's a movie that sticks with you and you think about it for a while because I kept thinking about it for days and I had to rewatch it again. Just to make myself feel better?
I gotta tell you, this might be like the darkest watch list I've ever done.
Really?
Chernobyl, Confession Tapes, and Funny Games. It says a lot about you.
Yeah, and those are the things that I like to watch.
Yeah. Listen, I dig it. I'm guilty of that sort of same guilty pleasure as well. Brenda Song, thank you so much for being here on
thank
the IMDb
you.
Show. Congrats on everything.
Thank you.
Can't wait to see you do more and more great stuff.